Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Moment of Liberation in Western Europe, Power Struggles and Rebellions, 1943 to 1948, by Gerd-Rainer Horn, read by Michael Page. Introduction. The moment of liberation in Western Europe forms the end point or the starting point of countless history books, for good reason. The final end of a murderous total war constitutes a logical marker in historians' attempts to make sense of the past. This book takes a rather different approach. The moment of liberation is here understood as a roughly five-year-long period which formed a distinct era on both sides of 8 May 1945, the official date of the termination of hostilities in the European theater of World War II. It includes the final months, indeed up to 2 years, of war, occupation, and resistance, but also up to 3 years, depending on location and circumstance, of the post-liberation period. What unites the years from roughly 1943 to roughly 1948 is a series of events, designs, actions, and hopes which, taken together, gave this moment of liberation a peculiar flavor. To be sure, the end of the war, which wrought unimaginable destruction of lives and the material infrastructure of what was left of European civilization, was uppermost in people's minds as the key goal to pursue. Accordingly, the defeat of the Nazi army and the corresponding liberation of occupied Europe naturally played a crucial inspirational role for their respective political and military engagements. At the same time, the wish for such circumstances as had given rise to total war and Nazi occupation terror in the first place to never happen again emerged as an additional, increasingly powerful mobilizing motivation for large numbers of Europeans who had been fortunate enough to survive. In this book, I will consistently refer to activists in resistance organizations, whether military or civilian, as anti-fascists. I do so knowing full well that not all members of resistance groups would have identified with this label at all moments, or even at any, during their period of active engagement. Anti-fascism is a term encompassing a wide variety of political orientations and action repertoires. The lowest common denominator was the desire to put an end to specific national fascist regimes and/or Nazi Germany's or Mussolini's Italy's domination over one's native lands in the cases of resistance activists operating in occupied Europe. How to go about doing so was subject to widely differing ideas and conceptions, depending on whether activists emerged from democratic, anti-capitalist, anti-military, religious, or pacifist milieus. And Jens Späth, in a cogent recent contribution to the ongoing discussion of the parameters of anti-fascism, justifiably adds, after all, such contradictory groups as, for example, communists and conservatives all assembled under the umbrella of anti-fascism. As I will explain in greater detail in my conclusion, anti-fascism not only came in many colors, but it also underwent a considerable evolution over time. First emerging in the cauldron of post-World War I Italian politics in the run-up to the appointment of Benito Mussolini as Prime Minister of Italy in October 1922, fascism and anti-fascism took on transnational importance with the designation of Adolf Hitler as German Chancellor in January 1933. With the lightning military victories of German armed forces after 1 September 1939, fascism and anti-fascism became key issues of European and world politics for the duration of World War II, though anti-fascist sentiments underwent yet more serious developments in the course of the 5 years and 8 months of this murderous conflict. Pervasive patterns of collaboration in all occupied countries by eager local assistance to the Nazi enterprise on a daily, years-long basis had convinced many Europeans, as the moment of liberation appeared to be approaching, that the defeat and eviction of the Nazi overlords was a necessary but not sufficient measure to fulfill their dreams. A post-war order from which fascism, war, occupation, and terror would be banished for good was seen by many, almost instinctively, as a society in which the powers of traditional economic elites were massively reined in as well. having often staked their lives to combat the Nazi scourge along with various associated local quislings, in the moment of liberation, countless individuals had grown increasingly contemptuous of the pre-war status quo ante. The prophetic insights offered by the doyen of the Frankfurt School, Max Horkheimer, then living in exile in New York, penned in an obscure émigré journal in the very first days of what turned out to become World War II, "Whoever is not prepared to talk about capitalism should also remain silent about fascism," had unexpectedly but persuasively become common currency in the popular imagination of many denizens on the war-torn European continent by the mid-1940s. This book is an attempt to reconstruct the potentially system-transforming energies of anti-fascism at the moment of liberation in continental Western Europe. For, by the time liberation appeared on the horizon in 1944 and 1945, expectations of the concrete contours of the desirable post-war societies had risen to untold heights. The moment of liberation in Western Europe had inadvertently but inexorably become one of those rare and unpredictable moments of crisis and opportunity which, on occasion and in irregular appearances, leave their imprint on the society, politics, and culture of their day. In my 1996 European Socialists Respond to Fascism, in part inspired by certain discussions of closely related ideas by other social theorists, I first employed the concept of moments of opportunity to describe these brief incursions of peculiar social and political constellations when everything seems possible. Whereas opportunities for radical societal change in any direction are narrowly prescribed in the vast majority of historical moments, such rare instances do occur. When they do appear, predictions of the immediate future are outdated soon after they are made. In 1944 and 1945, the contours of post-war European society were seemingly up for grabs. In hindsight, of course, we now know that the moment of liberation in Western Europe in 1944 to 1945 brought to an end the long nightmare of fascism, but it did not bring about the end of capitalism, though it was not for want of trying. As the various chapters to follow will hopefully suggest, and as I will discuss in somewhat greater detail in my conclusion, the moment of liberation at the tail end of World War II may well have been the conjuncture of European history which could fittingly be described as the nadir, the absolute low point, of the popular acceptance of capitalism as a desirable social system in the 20th century. The peculiar conjuncture of a quasi-continental years-long battle between fascism and various forms of anti-fascism in the context of a terrifying and murderous world war had convinced a growing number of Europeans that the moment had come for fundamental social change. The ensuing chapters will concretize the pathways chosen and the most important battles lost and won. Another salient feature of this particular moment of transnational change was the fact that quite often the various sentiments expressed by grassroots activists in occupied Europe could not benefit from much meaningful coordination on a national or even regional level, let alone on a transnational scale. Yes, indeed, the issues facing anti-fascist activists from Athens to Amsterdam and from Palermo to Paris were in many ways remarkably alike, but the ferocity of Nazi oppression rendered meaningful and effective overall control of operations by anti-fascist activists the stuff of utopian dreams. Each unit of the resistance, whether civilian or military, in the last analysis had to rely on its own forces above all else. Yes, there were, of course, connections made, calls to action spread, and supplies and directives distributed, measures which gave some credence to the notion of anti-fascist resistance activists forming part of a powerful national and even transnational social movement. But anti-fascists, finally dispersed throughout occupied Europe, operated in the last analysis with limited concrete links to like-minded activists elsewhere. Ultimately, all too often, they were thus left to their own devices. yet what obviously in some very important respects constituted a major handicap, in other ways provided a powerful example showcasing the independent and autonomous social power and political clout of anti-fascist resistance in particular and mass-based social movements in general. By force of circumstance, the anti-fascist moment became one of those rare, almost textbook-like moments in history when, for practical purposes, no single organization, no matter how beholden to centralized Jacobin ways of doing politics, could truly dominate or manipulate the many individual manifestations of a powerful social movement operating in any given region or country, let alone on an international scale. In other words, anti-fascism provided a laboratory of social and political action in order to study what large numbers of people may want or what sorts of visions of the desirable future society they may create if there is no one in authority to tell them what they should want. Resistance activists were forced to rely on their own inventiveness and power for most phases of their engagement in social and political action under the Nazi yoke. It is therefore, in my view, all the more remarkable that anti-fascists in many locations, certainly where resistance had become a veritable mass-based social movement, came up with astoundingly similar ideas and practices. Later, we will hear that grassroots forms of democratic representation, most often termed liberation committees, saw the light of day in the most remote locations of Europe in the process of liberation before, during, and after liberation itself. And, of course, the similarity of experiences affected more than merely the forms of effective and efficient political representation of the various anti-fascist currents in locations throughout Nazi-occupied Europe. The moment of liberation is a perfect occasion to study the inventiveness and creativity of social movements in a specific moment of crisis and opportunity, which is how the years 1944-5 presented themselves across almost the entire continent of Europe and in significant other portions of the world, above all in East Asia. In my prologue, as a teaser of sorts, I draw attention to a relatively little-known incident precisely at the moment of liberation in a part of Germany where, at war's end, neither the American nor the Soviet armies occupied a relatively populous stretch of territory, inadvertently leading to the de facto creation of novel institutions of self-government. Such liberation committees, in Germany they were then most frequently called Antifa-Ausschüsse, were far more widespread and pronounced in France, Italy, Yugoslavia, and Greece, where they had emerged already earlier under rather more promising conditions, though with widely differing concrete manifestations of such phenomena. Chapter 1 reconstructs the turbulent and much neglected history of the French variant of these organizational innovations, liberation committees. They constituted, within the limits imposed by circumstances, the most democratic instances of popular representation available in the tempestuous months prior to, during, and above all in the aftermath of liberation. Unsurprisingly, they also fashioned the most serious challenges to the return to the pre-war status quo ante in Republican France. Chapter 2 draws attention to the powers, the functions, and the history of identical institutional innovations in Italy. In Italy, however, the challenges to traditional forms of government were yet more widespread and deep-going than in France. Chapter 3 casts a detailed glance at liberation committees on the factory and office floors in Italy and France, with a brief discussion of the explosive powers of such grassroots democratic structures at the moment of liberation in communities of poor peasants and landless laborers. Chapter 4 should be understood as a case study of the promises and perils of the moment of liberation in the influential field of journalism and the production of information and ideas. Here, the story told is a tale of the massive changes affecting ownership, management, and the editorial lines of the crucial daily newspaper press at the moment when liberation finally arrived, and the amazing efficiency and rapidity of the return to the pre-war status quo ante. Chapter 5 points to what I regard as the last stands of the radical resistance spirit, long after the liberation committees, which form the essential target of my attention in chapters 1 to 3, had disappeared. an important word of warning about what is not covered in this monograph. This book is no general history of the moment of liberation in Western Europe. A comprehensive survey of the vicissitudes and ultimate outcome of this era would need to address at the very least four additional topics: the largely non-existent purges in all areas of political and economic administration in post-war Western Europe, the role of the Allied presence throughout much of the continent at the moment of liberation, the fundamental continuities of economic and political elites, minus its Jewish components, in Western European societies, and a concentrated view of the role of the most important political parties within the anti-fascist camp in this era. To do full justice to these four features of the moment of liberation would have required much additional research, and in fact, for practical purposes, a completely separate research agenda. It would also have required a doubling or even tripling of the size of this monograph. I had neither the time nor money to carry out such extensive additional archival forays, nor did I wish to produce an even more voluminous study, which, correspondingly, fewer individuals would be likely to ever really read. On the role of the Allies and some political parties, certain sections or comments in this monograph will suggest my train of thought. Thus, for instance, I am more convinced than ever that, in the end, Allied policymakers played a decidedly secondary role in shaping this tempestuous conjuncture. This is not to be confused with the obviously primordially crucial role of Allied military engagements. Civilian politicians in the countries under study were primarily responsible for the choices made and the pathways taken. Had French or Italian politics at the moment of liberation taken a more radical turn, then perhaps the role of Allied military governments would have become more proactive. We will never know, for there was no need for such potential interventions on any larger scale. The choice to focus on liberation committees and associated radical experiments has ultimately much to do with the red thread which has formed the leading motivation for all my historical work. I wish to spend my energies not primarily on betrayals and defeats. I wish to point out and highlight instead crucial instances in the history of 20th century Western Europe when disadvantaged and subaltern population groups, i.e. the vast majority of Europeans, have attempted to chart an independent course of action in the direction of a qualitatively different world. Prologue. Republik Schwarzenberg. It is still an unresolved question why it happened. But literally in the closing moments of World War II, when the American and Soviet armies converged in central Germany, the impossible occurred. A stretch of German territory with roughly 500,000 inhabitants in the southwestern reaches of Saxony, from the foothills of the relatively industrialized Erzgebirge all the way to the borders with Czechoslovakia, roughly halfway between Chemnitz and Karlovy Vary, remained unoccupied by either the American or Soviet armies for more than 5 weeks, in some cases up to 7 weeks. From 8 May 1945 until mid-June or even later, two Landkreise and two towns, Aue und Schneeberg, were left to their own devices. At some point at the beginning of this unusual moment of military and political vacuum, virtually every single community in this Niemandsland had pleaded with American commanders of units stationed just to the west to include the Landkreise Stolberg and Schwarzenberg in the American occupation zone, but to no avail. In fact, some parts of this semi-rural, semi-industrialized Niemandsland had been liberated by American troops, but they subsequently withdrew to leave the baffled population to cope on their own. Red Army units stationed further east likewise abstained from any involvement in the civil affairs of the Niemandsland until mid-June, when they began to slowly make their presence felt following an agreement with the American side on the division of the territories they had conquered in central Germany. The inhabitants of this Niemandsland were thus forced to tackle the administrative and political challenges of the initial post-capitulation days and weeks all on their own. The curious case of this Niemand's Land is thus a tantalizing case study of what a population decides to do when forced to rebuild their lives by themselves, when there is no higher authority present to tell them what to do. For up to 7 weeks, the administration of the Niemand's Land became a laboratory experiment of self-administration. Of course, the circumstances of such an enforced self-government were not exactly propitious. The last surviving member of the new makeshift local government of Schwarzenberg, Paul Korb, recalled in 1995, "In the castle and in several schools lingered about 1,000 injured German soldiers. In pubs and factory halls, about 6,000 refugees and homeless, because of bombing raids on cities nearby, Dresden was a mere 60 kilometers away, had found temporary shelter. Several thousand prisoners of war and forced laborers lived cramped lives in nearby camps. Destruction of houses, public buildings, and civilian lives in the Niemandsland itself had been relatively limited. But the challenges of organizing daily life and the survival of 500,000 people were, as can be easily imagined, manifold after 12 years of Nazism and 6 years of total war. For one thing, the local Nazi administration was, initially, relatively intact. Still, as late as 9 May, 10 May, and 11 May, entire units of the Wehrmacht marched in unison, fully armed, through Schwarzenberg. The power of the Nazis had not been conquered. Nonetheless, public order began to disintegrate. Regular channels of food supply had vanished. Theft and pillage became rampant. Isolated houses and farms became particular targets for plundering. The area had undergone a certain industrialization in earlier decades and indeed centuries. Thus, the workers' movement had been relatively well represented up to 1933 in what by May, June 1945 had become the Niemand's Land. Paul Korb continued, "What could we anti-fascists do? I spoke about this with two comrades on the morning of 11 May in the Wildenau neighborhood of Schwarzenberg. We planned for a discussion on this issue with others. We then met in the forest near Bermsgrün, 6 men and 2 women from Schwarzenberg, 2 social democrats, the other 4 communists. Our deliberations lasted barely a half hour. The result? Back to Schwarzenberg in order to mobilize other anti-fascists and to procure arms, to occupy City Hall by that evening, also the local headquarters of the Gestapo, the regional Nazi Army command post, and the Brown House, the building of the local NSDAP, to disarm the Nazis and to arrest their leaders, to make contact with the forced laborers stuck in their camps. At 10 p.m. that night, about 100 armed blue-collar workers invaded City Hall and arrested the policemen and members of the armed civil guard, a force created by the Nazi mayor of Schwarzenberg in the final hours of the Thousand-Year Reich. The next day, 12 May, a 15-member action committee, eventually called the Anti-Fascist Action Committee, addressed the town's population in an open letter. Between 8 May and 15 May, in many locations in the Niemandsland, similar anti-fascist action committees were formed in most locations of some size. On 23 May, a central regional action committee located in Schwarzenberg capped the system of enforced spontaneous self-government. Importantly, this regional action committee, Bezirksaktionsausschuss, was elected by the local action committees, and these grassroots organs of self-government retained the statutory right to revoke and re-elect their coordinating committee in Schwarzenberg for the duration of this experience. The members of the various local action committees represented anti-fascist public opinion on location, notably social democrats, communists, liberal democrats, and individuals without any party political affiliation. Often, great care was taken to ensure equal representation by locally present and active political organizations. In the important population center of Auer, by June 1945, communists, social democrats, and liberal democrats each received precisely 10 seats on the local Aktionsausschuss. Initially, the Aktionsausschüsse attempted, where possible, to cooperate with the old town administrations in order to face the multiple and daunting recalibration of public order and attendant seemingly insurmountable tasks. But within about 2 weeks, the committees saw themselves forced to unseat most of the old guard town officials in important positions of power. From the beginning, however, the action committees had assumed executive powers in terms of political decision-making, denazification, and the replacement of compromised individuals, and thus gradually more and more key positions were controlled by the new authorities. The former and future Minister of Saxon Regional Government, the Social Democrat Alfred Fellisch, concisely described the political situation in the Niemandsland towards the end of May 1945 in the following terms. In the absence of any form of national government or superior authorities, today the Landräte and the mayors are the sole traditional officials on location. But these authorities now obtain their executive and legislative powers from the action committees, which have replaced the traditional regional and local political powers until new regulations for the administration of Germany have been determined by an eventual decision of the Inter-Allied Control Commission. The action committee is now the incorporation of public power, police powers, and administrative legality. Its decisions call for unconditional obedience. Its decisions are even binding for the Landrat. The affinity of this dense web of action committees with forms of direct or grassroots democracy, a timeless and vibrant tradition of the workers' movement, which even a dozen years of Nazi terror had not been able to excise from living memory, is further substantiated by the frequent recourse to general assemblies in many locations in the Niemandsland, where sometimes rather important decisions were taken, such as the election by secret ballot of a new mayor in the village of Erla. When the Allies by mid-June decided to assign the Niemandsland to the Soviet occupation zone, the Action Committee's time was up. The Soviet policymakers were no more inclined than their Western allies to foster, or even to tolerate beyond the necessary minimum, experiments in democratic self-government which bypassed and contravened traditional structures of political and administrative hierarchies. From mid-June 1945, the action committees began to be sidelined and marginalized, if not outright dissolved. Leading activists were integrated into the newly revitalized traditional administrative structures of a given locality, usually in consulting positions. Some survivals of the erstwhile action committees eked out an existence for more than a year. Nowhere in the Niemandsland did the action committees actively resist their effective dissolution, no doubt at least in part because of their keen awareness of their total isolation in a post-capitulation Germany, where the four allies held total power. Antifa Ausschüsse in Germany. The spontaneous emergence of such action committees was by no means a peculiarity of the Niemandsland. The sole distinctive and decisive feature of anti-fascist action committees in the Erzgebirge region centering on Schwarzenberg was their assumption of effective local and regional powers, if by default. Elsewhere in Germany, at the point of capitulation, liberation, similar organs emerged as well, with an amazing and surprising regularity. Their adoptive label differed from case to case, with the term antifascistische Ausschüsse or Antifa Ausschüsse perhaps the most common denominator. Without exaggerating their, on the whole, marginal role in most locations at the point of liberation in Germany, their presence did make itself felt in countless cities, large and small. Their membership was, on principle, very similar to the political spectrum assembled in the Niemandsland committees. The entire spectrum of anti-fascist underground public opinion was represented, with a notable preponderance of activists belonging to the erstwhile, pre-1933, popular parties of the workers' movement, social democracy, and communism. Time and time again, however, individuals from the rather tiny left socialist or dissident communist tradition played a disproportionately important role in the establishment of such Antifa Ausschüsse. But their effective role in the reconstruction of public life and public policy was almost uniformly marginal. With few exceptions, leaving aside the Niemandsland, their designs far exceeded the constraints of political and military circumstances at the point of liberation capitulation in all four occupation zones of defeated Germany. Jeanette Michelmann highlights the exceptional cases of the small or medium-sized towns of Pirna, Schmiedeberg, Meissen, and Waren as locations where, even if just for a limited time, Antifa-Ausschüsse effectively replaced traditional local governmental structures. Rebecca Berling, in her important study of Frankfurt, Stuttgart, and Munich at the moment of liberation, in which she notably draws attention to the work of the Antifa-Ausschüsse, concludes with similar observations on the origins, meaning, and demise of such embryonic forms of governmental constructs. In terms of the formality of their structure, in all three cities, Antifas were created both spontaneously and informally. In none of the three cities did they actually operate as municipal governments, although they did occasionally function as district administrations in outlying areas such as Höchst on the outskirts of Frankfurt, Alte Heide in Munich, Geisberg, Zuffenhausen, or Unter- and Oberturkheim in Stuttgart. There are no signs that the Antifas in Munich, Frankfurt, or Stuttgart were interested in taking over the entire city administration or functioning as Soviets or Räte per the 1917 Russian or 1918 German models. Usually these committees were created literally in the heat of the battle at the very moment of liberation capitulation. The initiators of these committees often knew each other from informal contact in the preceding years under the Nazi yoke, if not already from common activities in the days of the Weimar Republic. But only rarely, usually in the bigger cities, did such committees emerge out of pre-existing formal ties amongst their leading members. Their role prior to liberation was therefore negligible at best. Still, it is worth underlining some exceptional experiences, due more to unusual circumstances than conscious design, which elicit faint echoes of similar actions by similar committees in other countries, which I will concentrate on in the rest of this study. As we will hear, in France and Italy, and even more so in Greece and Yugoslavia, countries which, however, I will not cover directly in this book, similar committees, though with incomparably firmer local and social anchorage in their respective populations, carried out the fight against Nazi occupation and local quislings for many months, even years, prior to liberation. As a consequence, as we will hear, vast chunks of France south of the Loire and west of the Rhône and most of central and northern Italy, from Florence northward, were quite literally liberated by partisan formations operating under the political leadership of liberation committees, to be sure on the coattails of Allied victories elsewhere. In Germany, where the political circumstances, as well as the nature of the geographic terrain, did not allow the emergence of anything even remotely resembling the underground resistance movements on the other side of the Rhine and the Alps, the feeble shoots of underground resistance activity could almost never even dream of playing any role whatsoever in the military liberation of Germany. There are, however, some exceptions which deserve brief discussion, as they permit the establishment of certain parallels between anti-fascist action committees and their vastly more powerful and influential sister organizations to the south. The literature suggests that in a few isolated cases, such committees, or the functional equivalent of such committees, played a role in the liberation of some German towns. Peter Buchwitz refers to the military self-liberation of Stolberg, one of the important population centers in the Niemandsland, by the combined efforts of two pre-existing groups of resistance activists during the night of 7 to 8 May 1945, the two groups subsequently merging their efforts in the Stolberg Action Committee. And, of course, the description of the seizure of power by the Schwarzenberg Action Committee on 11 May, with which I opened this prologue, can be easily seen as a similarly bold act. Ulrich Schroeder, in a stimulating discussion of what he terms regional liberation movements in southern Bavaria and Austria, points to the spectacular success of a local underground network in Oberstdorf im Allgäu, better known as a popular tourist destination in post-war West Germany, in capturing local power in advance of Allied forces. In the course of April 1945, a local Heimatschutz had been created from scratch, eventually counting 200 local civilians, but notably including a number of German soldiers stationed there. During the night of 30 April to 1 May 1945, the Heimatschutz seized key strategic points in Oberstdorf, arrested leading Nazi representatives, and then established contact with slowly approaching French military units, organizing the Kampflose entry of Allied troops into Oberstdorf in the course of 1 May 1945. Rebecca Berling draws attention to a similarly spectacular action, only this time in the capital city of Bavaria, Munich, not a provincial backwater like Oberstdorf, an action, however, decidedly not crowned by success. In Munich, a grouping composed of various civilian and military circles, the Freiheitsaktion Bayern, FAB, during the night of 27-28 April 1945, took over Munich area radio stations and, for the 12 hours in which the FAB controlled the airwaves in the Munich region, it declared an open season on Nazi functionaries. Timed to coincide with the liberation of the Dachau concentration camp, the agitation of the FAB led to some sympathetic revolts in some Munich suburbs, but was eventually brutally suppressed. Still, an article by a star journalist in the influential The New Yorker magazine highlighted the FAB action, reporting the fairly incredible fact that somewhere in Germany I saw living Germans who had risked their lives fighting the Nazis. Yet the most astounding self-liberation of a German-speaking city occurred in the unlikely location of Innsbruck, Tyrol. The 1938 Anschluss, initially euphorically supported by countless Tyroleans, had lost much of its luster towards the end of the war, and by late April, early May 1945, bad luck would have it that the final paroxysms of Nazi military might in the Alps would play themselves out in the Tyrol and Salzburg regions. Increasingly convinced of the senselessness of military engagements against Allied forces only a few days before the war's end, growing numbers of Tyroleans began to exhibit sympathies with a number of resistance groups which had sprung up over time. On 2 May 1945, a joint action by military and civilian members of resistance organizations took over the most important garrison in the militarily important city of Innsbruck. The regional Nazi military command structures were effectively dismantled and its leading officers arrested. The local police were likewise placed under the command of resistance activists. On 3 May 1945, there were still some deadly skirmishes with SS units in the city's streets, but by 5 p.m. the city of Innsbruck, the biggest city in the western third of Austria, had been liberated. When American troops first entered Innsbruck that very evening, the city's streets were draped with flags sporting the Austrian national colors, red, white, red. The official report by the U.S. Infantry Division expressed the Allied soldiers and commanders' utmost joy and surprise. It was like the liberation of Paris. Stefan Heim. The curious case of the Niemandsland on the northwestern slopes of the Erzgebirge first obtained a certain degree of notoriety when Stefan Heim, a major literary figure whose novels cover important aspects of German and European history in the 20th century, published a utopian novel in 1984, Schwarzenberg. In this fictional account of the peculiar local events during the short spring of unexpected opportunities in 1945, Heim portrays the story of the successful establishment of a democratic socialist republic in what he labels Republik Schwarzenberg, a tongue-in-cheek fairy tale of a buoyant example of self-government and participatory democracy, which is meant to suggest the inherent potential exemplified by the brief experiment in the Niemandsland. Stefan Heim knew only too well that actual history differed significantly from his utopian parable. But as we will hear, and as I already alluded to earlier, elsewhere in Europe, in France and Italy, also in Greece and in Yugoslavia, the moment of liberation witnessed far more important instances of local self-government, with liberation committees, as the French and Italian and also the Yugoslav equivalents to the German Antifa Ausschüsse were called, constituting for some time, days, weeks, and sometimes even several months, the effective organs of local government. In many locations, including major towns and even cities like Toulouse or Marseille in France, or most major population centers in northern Italy, notably Turin, Genoa, and Milan, the traditional structures of local and regional government usually continued to function simultaneously or side by side with the dominant liberation committees. More often than not, mayors and municipal councils, and even prefects, were appointed by liberation committees, just like in the non-fictional case of the German Niemandsland, and thus even regional governments were far more likely to be guided and controlled by the new organs of self-government than the other way around, up to a point. Stefan Heim's first three novels had originally been written and published in English. The young anti-fascist Heim had hastily left Germany in late March 1933, illegally crossing the border into Czechoslovakia on his skis in the snow-packed Riesengebirge, eventually finding a new home in the United States. As a member of the Psychological Warfare Division, Heim participated in the invasion of Normandy, the liberation of Paris, and the Battle of the Bulge all the way to VE Day at the Elbe. Then, Heim worked on the editorial board of German-language Allied military government publications in the Ruhrgebiet and Munich. His third novel, Crusaders, a novel of only yesterday, became his first international success. In Crusaders, Heim draws on his first-hand experience in the American army in 1944-5, pointing out the contradictions of a liberation army which is meant to occupy foreign lands, giving flesh and blood to the wide range of characters and character flaws among officers and GIs, from courageous and daring soldiers to black market profiteers. Stefan Heim was thus ideally prepared and well poised to write his utopian novel about the Niemandsland turned into a democratic socialist commune. Though expressly designed as a comment on German and also, but by no means only, East German history, it could, and perhaps should, thus also easily be heard as a parable in light of what happened further south in Europe, a remarkable but not very well known story to which we now turn. The early stages of liberation in Europe. The first significant chunk of territory in Western or Southern Europe to be liberated from the Axis dictatorships was Sicily. In a campaign lasting from 10 July to 17 August 1943, British and American troops managed to sweep the German army across the Straits of Messina. On 3 September 1943, British and Canadian forces began their invasion of Calabria from Sicily. On 9 September, two further Allied landings occurred, a relatively small Allied force in Apulia and the main invasion force in Salerno, south of Naples. The subsequent liberation of southern mainland Italy became a long and costly campaign. The second island to be liberated was Sardinia, when, in the evening of 17 September 1943, the German troops on Sardinian soil crossed over to Corsica, the next island further north. The Allied invasion of Sicily had begun with Mussolini still in power. Realizing that the days of Italian fascist power might well be numbered, on 25 July 1943, Italy's supreme political command, the Grand Council of Fascism, voted to depose Mussolini and hand over powers to King Victor Emmanuel III, with General Pietro Badoglio in effective control. Ostensibly still allied to Germany, secret negotiations with the Allies now took place, ending in an armistice agreement secretly signed on 3 September 1943. On 8 September, the armistice was publicly announced, instantly leading to the lightning-speed takeover of Italy by German troops, except, of course, for the portions already liberated by Allied troops, to replace the suddenly neutralized Italian armed forces. This Operation Axis was a stunning military success. Apart from portions of Calabria and Apulia, Sardinia was the sole significant territory in Italy where Italian troops openly sided with the Allies, fought against the German presence, and thus managed to liberate the island from Nazi control by 17 September. The first part of French territory in Europe which was liberated from Nazi rule was, it is sometimes forgotten, Corsica. The island of beauty, just like much of southeastern France, had been occupied and administered by Mussolini's Italy since November 1942, and thus Corsica chafed under the presence of no fewer than 85,000 Italian occupation soldiers, with the first contingent of 12,000 German troops arriving in July 1943. Though the commanders of Italian troops in Corsica at that point gave the order to consider German forces their enemy after Mussolini had been deposed, the brunt of the liberation of Corsica was carried out by French forces. Overriding the opposition by General de Gaulle, who wished to await the arrival of Allied troops, General Henri Giraud, from June to November 1943, co-president of the French Committee of National Liberation, CFLN, about which more in Chapter 1, led troops of the French Liberation Army, AFL, into battle against Nazi troops in Corsica. The AFL consisted of French troops in North and West Africa, whose commanders had refused to pledge allegiance to the Vichy regime. With the complicity of the numerous Italian soldiers still stationed on Corsican soil, the troops commanded by officers under the overall leadership of Giraud, notably including 6,600 soldiers of a Moroccan infantry division, supported by Allied airstrikes, engaged in a four-week-long military campaign against the 30,000-strong German forces on Corsica, 9 September to 4 October 1943. Sicily had been liberated by Allied troops, Sardinia by Italian forces whose commanders had just switched sides. In Corsica, an entirely new phenomenon had occurred. The regular troops of the AFL, under the political leadership of the CFLN, were not the only military force who contributed to the liberation of Corsica, with the last German soldiers leaving by boat from Bastia in the northeast of Corsica during the night of 3 to 4 October 1943. Beyond the shadow of a doubt, military activity by Corsican resistance units played a significant role as well in the liberation of what became the first free territory of metropolitan France. The opening salvo of Corsican liberation had been the takeover of the prefecture of Ajaccio, the capital city of Corsica on its western shores, on 9 September 1943. The organization responsible for the assault on the prefecture had been the local Comité de Libération. The Vichy prefect signed an agreement to hand over Corsica to the CFLN. Resistance units then participated side by side with the regular forces of the AFL in the four-week-long bloody battle to free Corsica. Ajaccio had thus become the first significant population center in Western Europe to be liberated by resistance fighters organized by their local umbrella grouping, the Comité de Libération. Between 27 and 30 September 1943, a similar battle to liberate a significant population center, ferociously fought over a period of four long days, found Italian resistance fighters confronting Nazi troops in the narrow streets and hilltop neighborhoods of Italy's third largest city, Naples. German troops pushed northwards by Allied soldiers had been ordered by none other than Adolf Hitler himself to completely destroy Naples in advance of the German retreat and the arrival of Allied liberators. The desperate and heroic actions by armed civilian insurgents in late September made it impossible for the plan of purposeful destruction of Naples to be carried out. The Quattro Giornate di Napoli, 4 days of Naples, just like the liberation of Corsica by a joint campaign of the AFL and Corsican resistance fighters, was a powerful and symbolic portent of things to come in the two countries which are at the center of this book, Italy and France. 1. Rebellion in the South, Liberation in France. The government of the Free French. The aforementioned CFLN, created in June 1943 in Algiers, stood at the apex of a complicated double hierarchy of underground and resistance groupings, military and civilian, for all of France. Charles de Gaulle, famously cultivating the image of premier résistant de la France, supposedly the first French citizen to take up the cause of the resistance, largely stood responsible for its creation and the overall outlines of its activities, though, as we saw in the case of the decision to engage in military combat to free Corsica, not without some major internal tensions and rifts. The CFLN, in effect, considered itself the legitimate political authority of underground and exile France, and particularly in the run-up to D-Day in the first half of 1944, the CFLN issued a series of important and far-reaching decrees which governed, or were at least meant to govern, the conduct of resistance units before and after liberation. On 3 June 1944, 3 days before the Normandy landing, the CFLN transformed itself into the Provisional Government of the French Republic to stake its claim to post-liberation authority in France. Separate from the CFLN, and until September 1943 frequently disregarded by the CFLN, a coordinating body of all resistance movements in metropolitan France formed in May 1943 the Conseil National de la Résistance, CNR. The spectrum of resistance groupings was particularly checkered in France, in comparison to other parts of occupied Europe, a situation partially the result of the division of France into two halves, a northern zone directly administered by German overlords and a southern zone initially administered for the Germans by the Vichy collaborators. Virtually all resistance organizations of more than just local importance existed either in the north or in the south. The sole influential organization to span both zones was the communist-dominated Front National. The CNR was created to ensure a maximum of coordination in the country as a whole. 6 anti-fascist political parties, from Christian Democrats to the Communist Party, were represented on the CNR in addition to 8 spokespersons for the most important resistance organizations. One additional spot on the governing committee was handed to the Trade Union Federation, the CGT, which since April 1943 once again included both socialist and communist traditions, another post to the Catholic equivalent, the CFTC. The CNR continued to play a role in French post-liberation politics. From early 1945 onward, however, the role of the CNR quickly diminished. By the summer of 1945, it had become a mere shadow of its former self. The third important institution which must be introduced before raising this narrative to the all-important grassroots level is an administrative innovation without equivalent in other European contexts at that time, the Commissaire de la République, Republican Commissars. First mentioned in deliberations in exile in the early summer of 1942, it was not until 1 year later that serious energies were devoted to the choice of such commissars throughout metropolitan France. Given virtually plenipotentiary powers, these Republican commissars, CRR, were appointed and subject to recall by the CFLN Provisional Government. Crucially, they occupied an administrative rank between the national government and the prefects, the latter the traditional safeguard for centralizing national governments in both Italy and France to ensure the swift and efficient translation of government decrees into administrative practice in all 4 corners of the land. Republican commissars were thus a regional transmission belt of the wishes of the exile government with, not only on paper, virtually unlimited powers. Some months after liberation, Paris began to rein in the CRR's remit. Their exceptional powers in theory did not last very long. From its 13 October 1944 meeting onward, the Council of Ministers of the Provisional Government began to limit them. Still, as in so many other areas of daily life and administrative practice, judicial theory and political reality by no means always worked in harmony. The creation of the Commissaire de la République was only one of the many decisions by the CFLN which de Gaulle and the Provisional Government eventually came to regret. Comité départemental de la Libération. Prefects thus stood below the CRR in the hierarchy of authority. Below prefects were, in theory, the mayors, municipal councils, and conseils généraux, the latter a form of representation comprising elected members in each département suspended under Vichy. I will return to these traditional French Republican modes of representation administration shortly. For the moment, it is necessary to turn one's attention to an innovation of French underground anti-fascist activity nominally guided by the CFLN, the Comité de Libération. The functional equivalent of the Niemandsland Antifa Ausschüsse, liberation committees were created, particularly in the second half of 1943 and early 1944, most frequently on the level of each département. Hence, the most common reference was the Comité Départemental de Libération, CDL. The autobiographical account of Francis-Louis Clauzon provides a good point of entry into the political and organizational work effected by CFLN emissaries such as Clauzon in order to construct this most basic building block of the new administrative hierarchy of to-be-liberated France. Yet no matter how important the initiatives emanating from the CFLN, the bulk of the energies directed towards the creation of CDL came from below. In some locations, similar bodies had already been in existence, if under a different label, a good example being the Comité de la France combattante de l'Isère et des Alpes Dauphinoises in the area around Grenoble. This umbrella group, initially assembling representatives from three regionally implanted resistance organizations, constituted in the autumn of 1942, soon expanded to include other groups. By early 1943, it included spokespersons from literally all locally operating anti-fascist groups and parties. Historians refer to this particular Comité de la France combattante in the Grenoble area as the first group to assemble representatives from the entire gamut of locally implanted groups in all of underground France. On 25 January 1944, nine representatives of the key underground organizations in the area met in a rural mountain hotel in Méaudre-en-Vercours to constitute the successor organization to the Isère Committee of the Fighting French, the Comité Départemental de l'Isère de la Libération Nationale, CDL Isère for short. From now on, it was this CDL which guided anti-fascist action in the greater Grenoble area. At this founding meeting in the Hôtel de la Poste, where, after some initial exchanges, the actual deliberations followed a lunch in the hotel, several important decisions were taken. Plans were discussed to prepare for an eventual insurrection and the takeover of power. Specifically, decisions were taken on how to organize the purges of the collaborationist press and the launching of a newspaper under the auspices of the CDL, the Dauphiné Libéré, the replacement of the leading echelons of public officials, and other measures to organize public life in Grenoble and the surrounding area after Day X. In Grenoble, the key organizer of the Monaco event had been a representative of the French Communist Party, PCF, Pierre Fleureau. In Saint-Étienne, Loire, a city dominated by heavy industry and mining, it was Gabriel Calamont, member of the Mouvements Unis de Résistance, MUR, from December 1943 onwards known as the Mouvement de la Libération Nationale, MLN, a fusion of the three largest non-communist underground organizations in the southern zone of France, who took the initiative to contact other resistance units in the area, notably communist-dominated groupings and the Catholic Équipe Chrétienne. The account of the formation and the early history of the CDL Loire by a participant observer at the founding meeting on 15 April 1944 and most subsequent gatherings of this body, René Jean-Jean, points to some serious internal conflicts within the CDL Loire in its early history prior to liberation. Grégoire Majarion, in one of the most insightful studies of the moment of liberation in France, suggests that contentious experiences, such as the ones reported by Jean-Jean in the Loire, were relatively common. The creation of these committees called forth intense political battles on several levels. First of all, the question of the respective representation of the military movements, political parties, trade unions, and other organizations was bound to give rise to conflicts. The reasons for such tussles not only had to do with conflicting claims for the role of communists in these committees and the fear of their infiltration and claims for disproportionate representation. The critical attitude on the part of resistance movements vis-à-vis traditional political parties, whose sensibilities provoked contempt, likewise constituted points of friction. Political parties frequently saw in their participation in liberation committees the unexpected opportunity to reappear and to reinsert themselves into the local and regional political culture after a prolonged period of relative passivity or even a de facto total absence. In Montluçon, Allier, for instance, for some time in the run-up to liberation, not just one but two local liberation committees existed, one dominated by communists, the other by socialists. In the only serious recent local study of a French liberation committee, Charles Riondet's Le Comité Parisien de la Libération, the author paints an evocative and detailed picture of the behind-the-scenes negotiations and manipulations prior to this committee's inaugural session on 23 October 1943, which itself was characterized by a tumultuous atmosphere, as this was not a symbolic gathering but still an ongoing part of the negotiations over the composition of its executive committee. Yet on the whole, the ultimate outcome of such difficult bargaining sessions did create liberation committees which were representative of anti-fascist public opinion in the respective localities and regions. The fear of communist manipulation, a justified concern in this period of high Stalinism, even and especially after the dissolution of the Comintern, was probably uppermost in the hierarchy of possible worries by contemporary participant observers. Yet even as outspoken a critic of communist manichaeism at the moment of liberation as Philippe Bouton concludes, incidentally, there are few cases where the presence of the PCF at the heart of these CDL is seriously overestimated in relationship to its actual activist presence. Such was the case in the Cantal, the Ardèche, or in the Vienne, but such examples do not permit hasty generalizations, especially because the opposite phenomenon was likewise very apparent. In the Drôme, the Haute-Savoie, or the Haute-Garonne, for instance, the degree of representation of the PCF within the CDL does not appear to correspond to their strength of its activist roots. Grégoire Majarian, criticizing other historians such as Charles-Louis Foulon, who cast aspersions on the prominent presence of communist or communist-dominated forces within the CDL, points out that even if one takes at face value the data presented by Foulon, according to whom 31% of CDL members in the north and 35% in the southern zone were communists, such figures are not necessarily significantly different from the initial post-liberation election returns, where the PCF obtained between 26% and 28% of the popular vote. The most authoritative and detailed study of CDL activity in France, Les Pouvoirs en France à la Libération, makes clear that by late 1943 or early 1944, in the 33 case studies of CDL, such coordinating bodies of resistance activity had become reality. Philippe Bouton adds, on day 10, all French départements showcased a CDL, with the exception of the annexed département in the Alsace-Lorraine region. What effective role did these grassroots anti-fascist action committees play in the dramatic circumstances of 1944 in France? The theory of CDL powers. Before delving into the actual daily practice of CDL in a variety of locations throughout France, it is necessary to take a close look at what the exile government of underground France, preparing itself for liberation and the takeover of political and administrative power, imagined should take place in underground and post-liberation France. The very first of the all-important statutes to govern, at least in theory, underground activity was a decree creating and defining the aforementioned administrative lair of Commissaire de la République, which authorized the CRR to take all measures and all necessary decisions in order to assure the maintenance of order in their administrative district. This initial salvo of CFLN intentions still made no mention of CDL. The first ordonnance to mention CDL was proclaimed on 21 April 1944 and was intended to address concretely the modalities of the exercise of political power after liberation. It stipulated the guidelines for the composition and functioning of municipal councils and the conseils généraux, which were obviously meant to provide a seamless continuity with French republican practices prior to Vichy. A short section, however, addressed the role of CDL. In each département after its liberation, a Comité départemental de libération will be established, charged with the task of assisting the prefect. It is composed of one representative from each resistance organization, trade union, or political party directly affiliated to the Conseil National de la Résistance and actually present in a given département. The CDL assists the prefect by informing him of the viewpoints expressed by all locally present elements of the resistance. It must be consulted on all decisions concerning the replacement of members of the municipal councils and the Conseils Généraux. It ceases to function after the reconstitution of municipal councils and the Conseils Généraux. Clearly, CDL did not play a central role in the political imaginary of the CFLN. They were to play supporting roles to help the post-liberation prefects to administer their terrain effectively. They were meant to inform the prefects of what the constituent organisms of each CDL thought. They were to be consulted in the creation of post-Vichy municipal and departmental councils. Above all, they were to quietly disappear once the traditional French republican forms of local government had been reconstituted. As we will hear, French history took a slightly different turn. To be sure, the other national organization assembling underground forces, the Conseil National de la Résistance, had a somewhat different appreciation of the work of the CDL compared to the CFLN leadership's ideas. On 23 March 1944, the CNR published its designs for the structure and function of the CDL, which diverged in significant detail from the restrictive vision offered by the CFLN. Both the CNR and the CFLN imagined the work of the CDL to be coming to a rapid and definitive conclusion soon after liberation and the attendant revalidation and rebirth of municipal and departmental councils. But for the period of clandestinity, and notably for the moment of liberation itself, the CNR had other things in mind for the CDL. Already, the opening paragraph of the 23 March 1944 Statute of Departmental Liberation Committees set a fundamentally different tone. The CDL were originally regarded as a simple consultative organ which would not begin to function until after liberation to aid the provisional government. Today, they appear to be, and they must become, the soul of each département, fighting for liberation under the leadership of the CDL. The first three tasks of CDL enunciated in the section of the document entitled Mission of the CDL were 1. In the period of clandestine action, to coordinate direct action against the enemy and its accomplices, to prepare the national insurrection and the tasks of the public powers for the day of liberation. 2. In the insurrectionary period, to train and coordinate the action of all patriots for the dismemberment of the German forces and the crushing of all enemy agents, and to facilitate the establishment of new public powers and notably of the representatives of the new central government. 3. Following the setting up of new authorities, to constitute the provisional representatives of the population of the département vis-à-vis the authorities designated by the central government and to aid the latter in carrying out their tasks. What actually happened in real life? Which statutes came closer to anticipating the reality of CDL activities, the CFLN's or the CNR's blueprints? As we will hear, both visions were far off the mark, but the designs of the CNR were less completely off target than the expressed desires of the CFLN. CDL in the moment of liberation. In the run-up to liberation, the key task of CDL consisted of the coordination of resistance efforts with all that this implied in concrete circumstances. The CDL thus played an inordinately crucial role in the first half of 1944 and in the summer of 1944, the season when most parts of metropolitan France experienced their final liberation. Obviously, resistance activists knew better than the average French person living through these momentous events that liberation was above all a consequence of the Allied invasions and the subsequent battles to push the German troops out of France. D-Day in Normandy, 6 June 1944, and the ensuing bitter battles fought throughout the northern half of France and from November 1944 onwards into Belgium, Luxembourg, and Germany were what allowed resistance units throughout France to prepare for and dream about impending liberation. At best, the exploits of resistance fighters themselves played a distinctly secondary role in pushing out the Nazi occupation forces from northern France. It is thus necessary to briefly describe the process of liberation of France to fully appreciate the role of the various actors in it. A second front was opened up by Allied troops landing on the Côte d'Azur on 15 August 1944, when Allied forces in the northern half of France had just liberated Chartres, not yet liberated Orléans, and 10 days were still to elapse before the liberation of Paris. Allied troops on the Côte d'Azur, with significant participation of AFL units, had the task of clearing out the Nazi occupants between the Rhône Valley and the border to Italy high up in the Alps, pushing north, while in Normandy the main direction of Allied forces was east. No account which plays down the decisive military role of the Allied débarquement can stand as a valid history of the liberation, writes one of the most clear-headed and well-informed historians of resistance and liberation in France, H.R. Kedwood. But the middle portion of this sentence, marked by ellipses in the citation, is equally important as well. And no account which minimizes the guerrilla successes of the FFI can stand as a valid history of the liberation. Whereas Allied forces pushing east from Omaha Beach sustained heavy losses and clearly bore the brunt of military engagements with the German army, things were different in the southeast. Alain Leray, a young career officer in the pre-Vichy French army and an accomplished alpinist, becoming one of the most famous and successful leaders of the resistance in the Rhône-Alpes region, reports in his account of the resistance in the Isère, "The American forces responsible for fighting their way up the Durance Valley planned to reach Grenoble in 90 days, 3 months after landing on the Mediterranean coast. They covered the distance in 7 days, almost without incident. No one, starting with the Germans themselves, disputes the fact that this retreat was caused by the pressure of the Marquis of Devoluy, Lou Le Croisot, of the Vercours, of Trièves, and of the Oison. The headlong flight of the Germans in the Dauphiné had begun. It accelerated in a series of capitulations. It was our reward for the long, cruel years of struggle. No one has the right to forget." Of course, it was no doubt the fact that the German army had thrown most of its resources against the Allied troops closing in from Normandy that accounts for the heavy Allied losses in the northwest and the relative ease with which Allied troops, ably assisted by the FFI, moved north from the Côte d'Azur. Nonetheless, in fact, much of the Rhône-Alpes region was liberated by the resistance in advance of the arrival of the Allied troops. Annecy, the capital city of the Haute-Savoie, the northeasternmost département in the French Alps, bordering on Switzerland and Lake Geneva, liberated itself already on 19 August 1944, when Allied troops were still hundreds of miles away, with the German garrison surrendering to the fighters emerging out of the Marquis. On 20 August 1944, the last German troops left Saint-Étienne, chased by units of the FFI. The Savoie, likewise in the northern reaches of the Alps, also liberated itself. In the Savoie, one town per day is liberated. Aix-les-Bains on 21.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.